Welcome to Denmark and to the west coast of the Jutland Peninsula in particular. It is a little bit windy here today, and to be honest, that's not really unusual. It is like that basically every day here. That doesn't stop the Danes from being amongst the happiest people on earth. And I think that that's because Danes really love to do three things that you need a lot of wind for: sailing boats, flying flags, and developing the modern wind industry. My name is Rosemary Barnes and I'm a wind energy engineer. And I want you to come on a tour of Jutland's historic wind turbines with me. I'm going to be talking through the design evolution that's happened and explaining some of the engineering concepts that are the reasons for those design changes. First stop in our tour is at this picturesque windmill in Lyngmøllen. The Danish translated literally to English actually means heather mill, and this is a mill made of heather, so that is quite apt. It was built in 1876 and of a similar style to the kind you would find all over Europe at that time. So some of the major differences between this old-fashioned style windmill and modern wind turbines are that the old-fashioned windmills ground grain. There's a millstone inside and the sails turn that millstone around and grind grain, whereas modern wind turbines generate electricity. Second, the number of blades. There's four sails on this one that would have made easy construction with a crossbeam, and it's easy to balance. The sails of this windmill would have been covered in sailcloth, and then the wind would push them around, really similar to the way that a sailing boat sails directly with the wind. That's in contrast to modern wind turbines, whose blades actually fly through the air, a lot like an aeroplane wing flies. In the late 1800s, Denmark was just starting to get electricity, and there was a guy called Pulakor. He was a teacher at an evening school for farmers. He really wanted electric lights to power his classroom, and he thought, since Jutland is such a windy place, that they should be using wind energy to make electricity. Pulakor was the first one to really systematically investigate the different parameters of wind turbines to figure out how you could extract as much energy from the wind as possible. And he did all that from a homemade wind tunnel in his little workshop in Asko. Now, unfortunately, there aren't any surviving wind turbines of his from that time. So instead, our first stop is going to be the world's longest operating turbine, which isn't too far away from there, in Tvind. I am here in Tvind at the world's longest operating wind turbine. Starting in 1975, it was actually built during the oil crisis when Denmark was considering adding nuclear energy. And this turbine was actually built as a sort of protest against the potential nuclear industry. The builders wanted to show that it was possible to get energy from renewable resources. It started operating in 1978. It was the largest wind turbine in the world. It has a tower height of 53 meters and a diameter of 54 meters. For our next stop, we're going to move forward in time to the 1980s, and we're going to see a few turbines from around that time. This turbine was installed in 1989 and it has a rotor diameter of 25 meters. So that's less than half of the diameter of the previous turbine we saw. And that one was built over a decade before this one. So you can see that I was right when I said that it was big for its time. So on the previous one, it had a concrete tower, whereas this one is made from a lattice structure. It's made from welded steel profiles, similar to the way that power lines or the Eiffel Tower are made. There's quite a lot of advantages of making towers in this way when they're small, up to around 30 meters. First advantage is that it can come to the site in small pieces, so you don't need a special truck to transport it. Secondly, it doesn't use a lot of steel, and it also, you can make it with a wide base, which will be nice and stable if there are strong winds. So if you have a wide base, then you don't need to build such a big foundation. There are some other reasons that designers moved away from lattice towers as they got taller, and I'm going to discuss that more when we take a look at some modern turbines. Our next stop is going to be a wind farm from the early 1990s, and you'll see that by then they had already moved away from the lattice tower to a tubular steel one. And there's another interesting design feature that I want to show you, which affects the way that they regulate power and how they slow and stop the blades from turning. I am at a wind farm with some more modern looking turbines, though if you look closely you can see that they are starting to show some signs of age. I think that this one is pretty old. Two main differences between these turbines and ones that you would see installed today. First of all, the size. They've got shorter towers, shorter blades. They generate a lot less electricity than the turbines that are being installed these days. And then secondly, you can see in this one over my shoulder, if you look at the tips, they're rotated. These are tip brakes, and they were used to slow and stop the turbine before you could rotate the whole blade. These blades are stall regulated blades, so you can't rotate them to change the angle of the blade relative to the wind. Instead, they regulated the power when wind speeds got high. They regulated it by allowing the airflow over the blade to stall. There are some disadvantages from this though. When stall occurs, the flow separates and it makes this violently swirling turbulent flow, causes a lot of vibrations which are unpredictable, and it shortens the lifetime of some of the turbine components. So once they figured out the challenges with getting bearings at the blade root to enable the blades to twist, that's called pitching, that's what they did. So you basically never see stall regulated turbines anymore. To Danish National Test Center for Large Wind Turbines in Østerild. There's turbines there from a whole range of manufacturers, and it's really cool because you can get right up close to them and get a good look. The manufacturers, they're constantly changing what they have installed there, so let's just go see what we can find there today. So the first thing you'll notice is they are big. They're getting so much bigger. Towers are getting really tall now to reach higher wind speeds above the ground, over 100 meters now for most modern wind turbines, and it's becoming really a challenge to get cranes big enough for them. Behind me is a turbine that's pretty typical of modern wind turbines. It has a tower height of 120 meters and blades of 75 meters length. It's got a tubular steel tower. It has three blades, and those blades are located on the upwind side of the tower. The longest blades that are made these days are over 100 meters long. These turbines are pitch regulated. That means that the blades can turn and twist so that the angle relative to the wind changes. When winds are very strong, you can change the angle of the blade relative to the wind so that the forces over the blade are reduced. This means that blades don't need to be designed as strong to withstand forces in a storm, for example, and it's also a way to make sure that you don't overload the generator. The blades can be rotated 90 degrees to act as a brake. It's like the tip brake in the stall regulated turbine that we saw, except you can imagine with the full blade surface area available, it's a much more powerful brake. So lattice tower structures are simple to transport, they don't use a lot of steel, and they're stable because they have a wide base. So why is it that we don't see those kind of tower structures anymore? There are quite some advantages from the tubular tower. First of all is installation cost. It's very simple to install these tubular towers. They'd come in just a few pieces that get bolted together. Second, they provide a nice weather and waterproof enclosure for electrical cables and a ladder or an elevator that is inside these large towers. This one behind me is 120 meters tall, so you can imagine that the service and maintenance crew are happy to have an elevator inside there. Thank you. up is going to be an offshore wind farm. And actually, this one is older than the turbines we were just at. It was installed in 2003. But the reason why I chose offshore for our final stop is that it's really only recently that it started to be a significant proportion of newly installed turbines are offshore. And this is definitely going to be a big part of the future. Now I'm at the Rimland wind farm. It's an offshore wind farm, but with the turbines quite close to shore, so that makes it easy for me to film so you can see them. Offshore is becoming a lot more popular recently, partly because good onshore sites are filling up, but partly because wind resources are really good quality offshore usually compared to onshore. So wind speeds are higher, they're more consistent, and without any hills or trees or buildings to stir up the air, you get a lot less turbulent airflow, which is better for the turbine. Of course, there's disadvantages to building foundations offshore is more challenging, especially in deep water. And then, of course, installation and maintenance are complicated by the fact that you have to transport teams to the site either with a boat or even a helicopter in sites that are really far away. So that's the end of our tour today. I hope that you've had as much fun as I have and learnt something about the design evolution of modern wind turbines.